world champion for Latin America. So that would be incredible to see if it happens. He would become the first ever Latin American world champion in the video game championships.
Absolutely. That's something that I know the entire region is waiting for. They believe it can happen. And if it's going to happen, it might just happen this weekend. We are going to take a quick break. Then we are going to be showing the top four matches over on the main stage. Both top four matches tonight will be cutting down to the final. So make sure you're watching those matches on the main stage. Hop on over from we'll actually be playing them on both stages. I was a little bit off on that one, got a little bit ahead of myself in my excitement. Still have the Latin American adrenaline running through my veins right now. So we are going to take a quick break and come back with a top four match here on the VG stream. Stay tuned. All right, everyone. Welcome back to the 2017 Pokemon Video Game World Championships here in Anaheim, California. My name is Evan Latt, and it is time for the top four matches. And who better to be beside me at the desk than the man, the myth, the legend, Ray Rizzo.
Evan.
It's getting late.
It is getting late, but these are some of the most important matches we're going to see of the entire event. We got to be hyped.
You're right. I got to save all my hype for the games. It's not about you anymore, Ray. It's about the new breed of world
champions. It was about me like 5 years ago. Not anymore.
Yeah, and now it's about Paul Ruiz and Sam Pandeles. Paul Ruiz representing Ecuador in the top four. The first time Ecuador has made it to the top cut, let alone the top four. Against Sam Pandeles from Australia. A really great showing here for the Australian region as well, for the Asia Pacific region. Both of these players competing for a spot in the finals, who will be competing for the first time either an Ecuadorian or an Australian could become the world champion.
Yeah, so this is really exciting if you're from one of these regions or a fan of one of these regions or even just a supporter of either of these players because, you know, this is the biggest moment to date in either of their careers. I mean, just getting to the finals alone is just such a huge, huge accomplishment, and it gives you the chance to play on stage in front of tons and tons of people and really show your stuff and prove that you belong in the finals at the World Championship.
All right, here is Paul Ruiz representing Ecuador on your screen. We just saw him take a convincing win 2-0 in his top eight match. Of course, using that Salamence and Snorlax very effectively, supported by the Alolan Marowak and the Celesteela. Also has that Tapu Koko and that Persian we had not seen in the previous matches. May see them in this one. Of course, he has a multiple event champion, the regional championship special events and top 16 at the Latin American Internationals, adding a top four position at Worlds and possibly even finalist and world champion if he can win a few more games.
Yeah, so really interesting team there. He's got multiple setup Pokemon with the Salamence, with the Snorlax, and multiple ways to protect them. Marowak can draw away any dangerous electric moves. Persian as well provides some support with the likes of Fake Out or Parting Shot, maybe even a tech move like Quash. It has so many possible support options. Tapu Koko as well. Usually you see a much more damaging Tapu Koko, but some Tapu Kokos elect for something like a Sky Drop to allow your Pokemon to set up even more.
All right, and his opponent is Sam Pandeles representing Australia, the regional champion in 2016 in Australia, top 16 at Worlds as well last year, improving on that position quite a bit here with the top four position. Of course, he also played very well in the national championships in 2016 and top 32 in 2014 in the Australian national championships. 2016, really a big year for this player, and now a top four world's position here in 2017. That is huge for him.
Yeah, he's definitely a very accomplished player, as you see there. He had a great performance at Worlds last year, does even better this year, but is hoping to improve upon the top four that he has right now, make it to the finals, and hopefully become world champion.
Yeah, and he will be relying on the Tapu Lele and Mandibuzz core alongside the Alolan Ninetales, Arcanine and Garchomp, and that Ultra Beast Zerkatry that no one was using at all during the season and now has made it to top four at Worlds. And we've seen it a number of times throughout this tournament.
Yeah, we have another kind of team that has multiple setup potential with the likes of Zerkatry with Tail Glow or Garchomp with Swords Dance. But then you have the support coming out from Intimidate from Arcanine, Tailwind from Mandibuzz. Ninetales is known for setting up that Aurora Veil, making it so difficult to take out.
Yeah.
You know, even Zerkatry becomes such a bulky monster, especially after it gets a Tail Glow. I mean, it's so tough to take out, and it just threatens so much damage.
Yeah, I mean, if that Zerkatry is able to get set up, then you have to imagine Paul is going to have to hope and pray that Marowak can stick on the field and just redirect all of those electric-type attacks away from its partners. Otherwise, Zerkatry might have a very easy time of this one. But as we saw in our last top eight match, Paul has shown that he is very good at identifying board states, able to maintain the type of positioning that he needs in order to protect his setup Pokemon. He's going to be really challenged by Sam on this one.
Yeah, he really is, because it's going to be very, very difficult to deal with this Mandibuzz in particular. You have Tapu Koko, but When the opponent has the likes of Zerkatry, which benefits from the electric terrain, it's always risky bringing Tapu Koko, and there's even a Tapu Lele, so depending on what terrain is up, if psychic terrain is up, Tapu Koko is just not threatening enough damage, especially since Mandibuzz is going to be carrying the psychic seed. It's just so difficult to take out. Salamence is going to need to get set up, I think. Try and get that Flyinium Z off, that Supersonic Sky Strike into the Mandibuzz slot. Maybe Snorlax getting set up, that's another option, but then you have to watch out for foul play. So this Mandibuzz is going to be really, really tough to take out by Paul. I think he's really got to focus on that. It's going to be tough, it looks like.
Absolutely, but this is the top four at Worlds. If it were an easy matchup, it would have happened 2 days ago.
That's right.
Both of these players really intensely preparing for this matchup here. You can see Sam on your screen. We are looking over Paul's shoulder. Really means a lot to both of these players to make it to top four, not just for themselves, but for all of their supporters and friends back home. In the break, I was on my cell phone on the Twitter app, reading some of those hashtag play Pokemon tweets out there. A lot of support for both of these players, and no matter what, one of them is going to make some people very happy.
Yeah, but no disappointment in losing in the top four, because that is such an incredible accomplishment. But when you're at this point, when you're at this stage, you don't even think about the what if I lose, you know. You think only about how close you are to becoming world champion, and you think of nothing else but that.
Stop at nothing but becoming the world champion. Team preview for both of these players. Paul Ruiz, again, we saw that Tapu Koko and Salamence, the Snorlax and Persian, the Alolan Marowak, and the Celesteela up against Sam Pandelis from Australia with the Garchomp, Ninetales, Arcanine, Mandibuzz, Tapu Lele, and Zerkatry. Really interested to see what adjustments Paul especially makes from the last set that we watched. Did not see Pokemon like Persian at all previously. Maybe a good choice here to sort of get those parting shots off to make sure that Sam doesn't have as much offensive pressure and just rearrange the board.
Yeah, I think though, if you're Sam, just the safe lead of Tapu Lele and Mandibuzz looks pretty safe here. You're not really worried about too much by leading those two. And then if you have some Pokemon in the back to deal with the Celesteela, you've got the Arcanine, you've got the Zerkatry. As long as you have one of them in the back for a Celesteela, you don't care. Just saving Celesteela for later. You've got safe switch-ins because you know Celesteela is going to be targeting down that Tapu Lele, so a clear switch into something is going to be needed. As long as one, even both of those Pokemon in the back, you're going to be in great shape if you're Sam, because Tapu Lele and Mandibuzz look like they have great matchups against everything else but the Celesteela on Paul's team.
All right, well, we are in it. We are in game one here of the top four match. Paul Ruiz of Ecuador versus Sam Pandelis of Australia. Paul will go ahead and lead the Tapu Koko and Salamence that did so much work for him in the top eight match, but Sam is going to match that with his Ninetales and Zerkatry. It's Zerkatry out on the field with that electric terrain. You mentioned it in team preview, Ray. That is one scary Pokemon, and especially with that Ninetales alongside of it.
Yeah, not a good matchup here for Paul at all. You set up the electric terrain for Zerkatry, powering it up even more. You've got Ninetales out on the field, which is very strong against Salamence. I'm really, really liking the lead here by Sam. He's got a great matchup against exactly this Tapu Koko Salamence lead. Depending on what kind of set the Tapu Koko has, though, it can definitely do some interesting things here, giving Salamence an opportunity to, for example, as we saw in the last match, it does have Earthquake, so if it's somehow able to get an Earthquake off onto the Zerkatry, that could do some major damage, but you got to do something about the Ninetales first.
Yeah, so scary to have that Salamence in with Ninetales on the field.
Exactly.
And Paul identifies that as well, switches out Salamence for Celesteela, really hoping to just tank some damage here, but Celesteela switching into a Zerkatry is not something you see very often. A lot of damage from that Tapu Koko onto Ninetales with the Volt Switch, so Paul will be able to continue to shuffle around his Pokemon here, showing Sam all of the Pokemon that he has in his roster this time around. Of course, that Alolan Marowak had to be the choice. If Paul was going to bring this Celesteela as well against Zerkatry. Ninetales able to set up this Aurora Veil, though, which will make sure that that Zerkatry, which is getting a huge special attack boost from the Tail Glow, is well protected from both of Paul's Pokemon.
Yeah, this is actually a really good turn for Paul. He's able to not only break a potential Focus Sash on Ninetales and deal some pretty good damage to it, but he's able to readjust his board position, get Celesteela in, which threatens the Ninetales, keep it safe with the Marowak, while Marowak is also threatening the Zerkatree with massive damage. Now, Aurora Veil is going to keep it safe, but Marowak still just deals a ton of damage.
Yeah, Marowak with that thick club has always done a lot of damage ever since that item was introduced into the game, occasionally even doing too much damage, rolling over and dealing no damage at all.
Yeah, I fully expect Zerkatree to protect here because, I mean, what else is it going to do? It can't go for an electric move. The other move it usually carries is Dazzling Gleam. Marowak and Celesteela both resist that, so you have to imagine Zerkatree will switch out and then perhaps protect while Ninetales switches out to provide a partner for Zerkatree that is at least threatening one of these two Pokemon, either Marowak or Celesteela, preferably the Marowak because Celesteela isn't threatening Zerkatree, but we'll see what comes in here.
All right, Ninetales will switch out for Arcanine, getting the Intimidate off onto both the Celesteela and the Marowak. The Intimidate plus that Aurora Veil going to make sure that Paul's damage output is minimal here. Even if Zerkatree can't deal that much in return, Dazzling Gleam will connect with Marowak and Celesteela, actually dealing a not insignificant amount of damage thanks to that Tail Glow boost. Shadow Bone from Marowak dealing less damage than the Dazzling Gleam because of that Intimidate and because of the Aurora Veil, as Celesteela gets a Heavy Slam off onto Arcanine. That's a critical hit, going to make sure that it deals full damage. It is the one risk of having all of this Aurora Veil and Intimidate.
Yeah.
Are still critical hits.
Yep, of course. But still a good position here for the Arcanine. The Intimidate's going to help a lot. And you threaten the Celesteela now. Marowak can't protect it from a Flare Blitz. Meanwhile, though, I do like the double target there by Paul because you, like I mentioned, you kind of expect Zerkatree to protect, but even though it didn't, that Dazzling Gleam did negligible damage, really not a lot, and Ninetales, a lot of times it doesn't carry protect, so you're pretty safe doubling into that slot, so I really like the combination there of the Shadow Bone and Heavy Slam. Gets Arcanine a bit lower, which is a threat to both of these Pokemon, but still, that Zerkatree is set up, you've got to preserve the Marowak, but if you can, then you are going to become able to take out the Zerkatree, which is going to be needed. So you got to preserve this Marowak here if you're Paul.
All right, well, Paul is opting to preserve the Celesteela this turn, protecting Celesteela while Zerkatree fires off another Dazzling Gleam. Will connect with the Marowak. It, you know, you say Marowak takes negligible damage from that Dazzling Gleam, but it'll only take one more, and then Zerkatree will be free to fire off all of its Thunderbolts. May not even need it as the Flare Blitz connects with Marowak, picks up the KO there, and Paul, without a Marowak on the field, Sam Pandelis correctly identifying that Celesteela would be trying to protect itself this turn, making those reads, taking out the Alolan Marowak, and this Zerkatree has no checks anymore.
Yeah, Sam recognized that Marowak was the one thing standing in his way from victory in this game number one. Decides to double target the Marowak, which was very, very smart. From Paul there, though, I would have loved to see him try and conserve that Marowak with something like a Protect. Now, Celesteela really isn't threatening a whole lot, so I don't know about switching it out. You don't want to go into either of the Tapu Koko or Salmons because Dazzling Gleam is still going to deal a ton of damage to those, so maybe just try and get some chip damage onto Zerkatree, maybe something like a Leech Seed, at least something. I really would have loved to see Marowak Protect. Try and stick around longer because you do need that if you're going to be able to take out the Zerkatree before it just sweeps your entire team because it's still very, very healthy.
Yeah, absolutely. It has not taken, I don't believe it's taken any direct damage yet.
Yeah,
just
only
that
the
hail.
Yeah.
All right, well, Paul using his full move time to reevaluate his positioning, reevaluate what his game plan is now that Marowak is off the field. Decides that Salamence is his best shot at bringing it back here against that Zerkatree, but again, we've already seen it show that Dazzling Gleam, and it's Dazzling Gleam is dealing a lot of damage to a Marowak that resisted it. Salamence does not quite resist Dazzling Gleam.
Yeah, though we do know from last match, Salamence was carrying Earthquake, although Zerkatree usually is trained pretty bulky when it goes for these kind of Tail Glow sets, and Aurora Veil is still up. This is why maybe I would have liked to see Celesteela, rather than protect, have Marowak protect and get Celesteela allowed to get a little bit of extra chip damage on Zerkatree so that by the time Salamence does come in and fire off an Earthquake, it is in KO range for that. But right now, with the health level that Zerkatree has, as well as Aurora Veil, I don't know if an Earthquake is going to be enough.
Yeah, and Paul really needs it to be enough. the Circuitry and this Arcanine threatening both the Salamence and the Celesteela. Arcanine opting just to support its pal Circuitry. Celesteela shows Wide Guard.
Oh, that's huge.
Showing the Wide Guard, which will allow Salamence to be protected from a Dazzling Gleam. Also, Salamence showing that it can move before the Circuitry here, get off an Earthquake. If it can get two Earthquakes off, that might be a really big deal. Dealing not that much damage to Circuitry. Circuitry goes for the Thunderbolt, though. Just going to try and take the Salamence out with the Thunderbolt this time around. Doesn't even need the super effective damage because it's gotten all of those boosts.
Yeah, really smart there by Sam. Recognize that Celesteela, probably carrying that Wide Guard, elects to go for the Thunderbolt combined with the Helping Hand. That's going to guarantee the knockout onto Salamence.
Absolutely.
Great play there because you know Celesteela is not threatening either of these Pokemon. And, you know, thanks to that Aurora Veil and just the natural bulk of Circuitry, it's able to take that Earthquake very well. And at this point, there's just not enough firepower on Paul's side to take out Sam's remaining Pokemon.
All right, well, Tapu Koko, the final Pokemon for Paul's side, really needs to get this Circuitry off the field. Celesteela, not going to be able to Wide Guard away a Thunderbolt against itself. Tapu Koko, probably not having enough damage to deal with all of these Pokemon with just something like a Dazzling Gleam. Is what you really want to do when you have
to
get multiple KOs.
It's going to need like Dazzling Gleam, double critical hit or something.
Well, you know, there's always a chance.
There is always a chance.
Well, Tapu Koko goes for the Dazzling Gleam here. Aurora Veil still up, though, not dealing anywhere near enough damage there. Circuitry also showing that it has an Iapapa Berry, so just going to heal up all of that damage. And Sam Pandelas, really well played with this Circuitry, going to make sure that it takes out so many Pokemon here, picks up the KO onto Celesteela. It's only one turn away from picking up a KO onto that Tapu Koko as well. Arcanine doesn't do it first.
Yeah, so very well played game one by Sam. That Circuitry just seemed like such a tough Pokemon to take out by Paul's side. And we kind of mentioned that in the pregame, just how difficult it would be because you have the likes of Tapu Koko. It's scary to bring that and just power up the Circuitry.
Right.
Celesteela doesn't want to deal with it. Your only real answer to it is that Marowak, but we saw Marowak just not able to be conserved. Even Salamence Earthquake after the Aurora Veil just not doing enough damage.
Mm-hmm.
And Dazzling Gleam just dealing massive damage to a number of these Pokemon. And then even against the Wide Guard from Celesteela, you still have the option of just Thunderbolting.
Mm-hmm. And that's going to be the forfeit coming out from Paul Ruiz. Sam Pandelas from Australia will take the first game here. A really well-played set there from Sam. I think the really big part of this was that Paul didn't really have a way to, you know, rearrange the turn order in some of these matches. He kind of left, in some of these setups, he kind of left himself at the whim of, you know, just the natural speed of some of these Pokemon. Might want to see something, you know, coming out from Persian, you know, even just like a fake out pressure to, you know, change the way that Sam is thinking when he's trying to set up these Pokemon. Or maybe just, you know, show that Wide Guard a little bit earlier, get that Salamence out a little bit earlier, or do something to stop that Ninetales at the start.
No, I completely agree, because the lead matchup was just, it was a disaster from the start. It gave Sam all the initiative to get set up first, but, you know, the way these teams are built, whoever gets set up first is in a commanding spot, so if that Salamence would have been able to get set up before Circuitry ever got set up, you're starting to see Earthquakes deal massive damage to a number of these Pokemon. It's able to outspeed Ninetales, so if you're able to have Salamence get set up without the threat of something like some kind of ice move from Ninetales, whether it be a freeze dry or a blizzard or anything like that, then you're in a much different position. So perhaps something like a Persian, like you said, that does give you a chance to get set up. You know, maybe that's the adjustment that Paul needs to make here in game two.
Yeah, and if Paul is afraid of that Ninetales there, a lot of information revealed there. Aurora Veil lasting basically the entire set there, basically showing off that Ninetales, if you can get it, it does not have that Focus Sash. It is carrying that Light Clay. You could pick up a one-hit KO onto Ninetales and make sure that that Aurora Veil is not a factor in this game.
Yeah, absolutely. So that's also key information for Paul heading into this game, because he does have options that can knock out Ninetales in one hit, specifically that Celesteela that we saw.
All right, well, it is game two time here. Sam Pandelas of Australia is up 1-0 against Paul Ruiz of Ecuador. Paul's tournament life is on the line, needs to win this matchup. opts for a changeup here, goes for the Marowak and Celesteela lead to catch these Ninetales and Zerkatry, the same lead Sam had last time, but Paul, much better position this time around.
Really good adjustment, because now Zerkatry, it can't risk trying to set up a Tail Glow because it'll just take too much damage from the Marowak. It can't go for a Thunderbolt again because of the Marowak and Ninetales as well. We saw it didn't have a Focus Sash, so if it decides to go for Aurora Veil here, it's trading its life for it. It's going to get KO'd either by Heavy Slam or Flare Blitz, whichever one, preferably the Heavy Slam, so that way Marowak can do a much more damaging attack into the Zerkatry slot. And Heavy Slam does have the potential to pick up a Beast Boost.
Yep.
So, you know, I'd like to see that from Paul, at least a Heavy Slam into Ninetales, because you do want to force Ninetales to risk its life if it wants to set up this Aurora Veil.
Well, Sam has decided that Aurora Veil is incredibly important for this team to allow his Pokemon to get set up. Zerkatry behind that Aurora Veil now, setting up freely with the Tail Glow. Both Celesteela and Marowak able to get off attacks here. The Flare Blitz connects from Marowak first into the Zerkatry. Paul's not even wasting time on the Ninetales, just trying to get as much damage on that Zerkatry as possible, while Celesteela's Heavy Slam is going to be able to pick up a lot of damage on that Ninetales. One hit KO through the Aurora Veil, and Sam able to get the Tail Glow onto the Zerkatry, but this time it was not even close to free.
Huge, and that defense boost could also matter if something like Arcanine comes in here, because right now Marowak is still protecting Celesteela, so now you're in a much better position should Arcanine come in to just protect Marowak. The Zerkatry starting to get low. It is close to its Bury range, but with the defense boost and Marowak protecting Celesteela from electric moves, Celesteela can start setting up Leech Seeds, start becoming really difficult to take out, doing a little bit of extra chip damage, and still, with the level of HP Marowak is at right now, I don't know if a double target is going to be enough at this point.
Yeah, Arcanine is the choice for Sam. Going to need a lot of damage out of that Arcanine to burst through this Celesteela with that Beast Boost and make sure that that Marowak can't continue to threaten the Zerkatry here. Again, we do know that the Zerkatry has that Iapapa Berry, so it may come down to some really interesting timings for when to actually go on the offensive against Zerkatry. You don't want to let it get that free HP.
Yeah, exactly. And with the hail still ticking, eventually Zerkatry will naturally just fall into that range to be to heal up with its Iapapa Berry.
All right, well, Marowak protecting this turn, Paul deciding that he didn't do a good enough job protecting the Marowak from the last round. Zerkatry will go for that Dazzling Gleam into the Marowak Protect, but Arcanine also sticking around. Celesteela taking the damage from the Dazzling Gleam. Flare Blitz from Arcanine will connect onto Celesteela. So it's all going to come down to what this Celesteela does on this turn. Super effective damage from Arcanine's Flare Blitz, putting it into pretty low health, while Celesteela just goes for the Leech Seed here onto Arcanine.
Yes, that's a really good read there by Sam, knowing that Marowak, being such an important Pokemon, is probably going to go for the Protect. Decides to double into the Celesteela. Now, Celesteela will regain a lot of this health thanks to Leech Seed and can always just protect the next turn if it's fearing another Arcanine Flare Blitz. So I like the position still for Paul.
Paul still has good position out here, and of course, having the Arcanine and Zerkatry, if Paul brought that Salamence again, would love to get a free switch in here to fire off one of those Earthquakes like we saw last time.
Yeah,
really important that that Zerkatry doesn't get the HP boost, though.
Exactly, and the longer this goes, the more chip damage is done to Pokemon like Arcanine. Mm-hmm. Should that Bury proc on Zerkatry, which it's probably going to at this point, you know,
maybe after just this hail damage, I'm not 100% sure.
Yeah, but if it does proc the Bury, you want to get at least a little bit more damage onto it so that Salamence can come in, outspeed both of those two Earthquake weak Pokemon, and fire off a really powerful Earthquake.
All right, well, Tapu Lele coming out here from Sam Padellas, setting the psychic terrain, the battlefield getting very weird here. Zerkatry just going to protect this turn. Sam deciding he wants to let that hail hit the Zerkatry and probably proc the Bury. Celesteela going for the wide guard, trying to protect against the Dazzling Gleam, but no attacks coming out from Sam. Marowak just going for a Flare Blitz into the Protect. Paul really trying to get that damage off before the Bury can get procced here, but that hail damage is going to be enough.
Yeah, so smart protect there by Sam. He wants to bring in the Tapu Lele to threaten the knockout onto Marowak. That's going to allow Zerkatree to then fire off a Thunderbolt into Celesteela. Of course, Marowak can protect this turn, so it is risky should a Heavy Slam go into that Tapu Lele slot, but there is, of course, always Arcanine in the back. Still, should Tapu Lele just want to switch out, get another Intimidate on these two physical attackers, which you have to think that's a safe play, so I would think, based on the way Sam's playing so far, might as well get the Arcanine in. It's not really at risk, and Zerkatree still very healthy thanks to just healing from that Bury. Seems like a pretty safe play.
Yeah, one of the interesting things about this game, however, is that by the time Aurora Veil had ended in Game 1, Sam had basically already won the game. Paul has been doing a really good job of putting pressure on Sam so that Sam hasn't been able to go as offensive as he did in Game 1. Maybe able to now stall out the Aurora Veil before bringing in that Salamence, which may be able to, you know, start picking up some KOs on Zerkatree and Arcanine that it couldn't before.
Exactly. Looking at the board state in this game, I think for Paul, the endgame is still going to be that Salamence.
Well, Tapu Lele was switched in just so Arcanine could come back in and get another Intimidate off onto both the Celesteela and the Marowak. So Sam playing really cagey, really defensive here. Paul switches out the Marowak, so bringing in his Snorlax this time. Snorlax now out on the field against Zerkatree and the Arcanine. Another Dazzling Gleam coming out onto the Celesteela, and Snorlax able to tank that pretty well, and Celesteela getting another Leech Seed off, this time onto Zerkatree.
Yeah, really, really good play there by Paul, realizing that Tapu Lele is not going to let itself get hit by a Heavy Slam, going to switch out, and getting Snorlax in here too. It's now saving Marowak for later. Marowak can still switch in at any point. Snorlax as well is threatening some more damage. As long as you get these Pokemon low enough for Salamence in the back, by the time Salamence actually gets in, Aurora Veil could be over.
And actually, by setting up this Leech Seed, Celesteela is also potentially, and switching out the Marowak, potentially setting up a way to get more recovery on that Marowak to keep it even safer.
Exactly. Should Celesteela switch out this turn too, Marowak that may be able to survive, should Zerkatree go for a Dazzling Gleam and Arcanine try and Flare Blitz that slot, Marowak should still hang on, but if not, then you're healing Marowak back up, and Marowak is a pretty bulky Pokemon and tough to deal with for these two Pokemon. You can only deal with it with the Tapu Lele, with what Sam has remaining, so this is going to be a really, really interesting turn here, and I really like Paul's positioning.
All right, well, Paul will retreat Celesteela for Marowak, wants to try and get Marowak some of that Leech Seed action. Zerkatree goes for the Thunderbolt. Finally, Marowak's Lightning Rod is going to redirect an electric-type attack. That's actually the first time I've seen that happen the entire tournament so far. Arcanine with the Flare Blitz will also connect with Marowak and deal a little bit of damage back. Not very effective. Gets the recoil. Snorlax has the high horsepower, but misses again. The second time Paul's Snorlax's high horsepower has not connected with its intended target. But Marowak now in against that Zerkatree. Would have loved to have gotten that high horsepower. Would most likely have picked up the KO there. But Marowak is still going to be able to stick around, annoy that Zerkatree, get some recovery as Zerkatree sticks around. And if not, that Snorlax can potentially threaten something else.
Yeah, that's still big, though. Paul's still in a good spot with this Snorlax.
Yeah, the Helping Hand coming out from the Arcanine onto Zerkatree while Marowak protects. Zerkatree needs to get as much damage off as possible before Zerkatree goes down. So uses the Dazzling Gleam onto Snorlax. Not enough damage. Brings it down to 21 hit points, but Snorlax is so happy to eat its Mago Berry and recover all of that up. High horsepower finally connecting there. A sigh of relief coming out from the crowd as Zerkatree goes down to red health, but that Leech Seed is the perfect amount
of health. Yeah, that's actually way better.
Extra recovery onto Marowak.
Exactly. Gives Marowak a little bit of extra healing, which is nice, and you still pick up the knockout, so best of both worlds there for Paul. He's down to Sam's last two Pokemon. He is going to be able to eventually get Salamence out at a perfect opportunity. Aurora Veil should be down by the time it does come out. There's still four Pokemon left. Not only can Salamence Earthquake to knock out the Arcanine, and if he gets Lele enough to knock that out, but he also has that Supersonic Sky Strike available, and Tapu Lele not very physically bulky typically, so if Tapu Lele maybe loses a little bit more HP, that's also going to be in KO range from a Supersonic Sky Strike, especially since Salamence doesn't have to worry about Arcanine at all when it comes to being damaged by it.
Yep, still two more turns of that Aurora Veil, but Sam needs to make the most of the damage while he has it. Helping hand from the Tapu Lele, the double protect coming out from Marowak. Marowak protected right here, gets the Psy Shock into the protect. Marowak is safe, Snorlax uses Facade, gets the damage off onto Tapu Lele. A critical hit. Paul Ruiz is waking Latin America up and ready to take this second game.
Yeah, now Psychic Terrain is gone, so Tapu Lele's damage output is going to be even lower, and the lower its HP gets, the easier it's going to be for Salmons to clean up in the late game.
Mm-hmm. At this point, Paul's really just looking at getting these Pokemon into Earthquake KO range. Failing that, just trying to clean up with his four Pokemon against Sam's final two.
Yeah, he really only has to get Tapu Lele into KO range from Supersonic Sky Strike because, you know, Arcanine doesn't threaten damage
anything
to Salamence at all. So as long as he gets Tapu Lele low enough, the game is going to be over.
Yeah, well, Tapu Lele getting the helping hand boost, but only able to target one of these Pokemon at a time with that Psy Shock, is going to target down the Marowak, pick up the KO finally this time on the Alolan Marowak. Snorlax's high horsepower is going to connect this time with the Arcanine, maybe expecting a protect from the Tapu Lele, but dealing some damage to Arcanine and getting it down to its berry percent.
Yeah, Marowak completely did its job in this match, and there's the Aurora Veil.
Finally
it's
gone.
Ended. Now's the time for Salamence to make its appearance and just clean this match up.
Man, so strong that Light Clay from the Ninetales. Having that Aurora Veil up the entire game really made a big difference and kept Sam in it. But Paul making some incredible adjustments from that first game, showing how he made it here into the top four and looking in a very good position.
Oh, absolutely. And it's so tough because we mentioned the Light Clay on Ninetales, keeping Aurora Veil around even longer. It's so tough to survive that many turns, though, against threats like Zerkatry with the Tail Glow up, you know, but Paul was able to do that. He was able to position his board incredibly well every single turn and put himself into a position now in the late game to just clean this up with his sweepers.
All right, Arcanine again going for another helping hand onto Tapu Lele. Wants that Tapu Lele to deal as much damage as possible, but Salamence wants to finish this off in style with that Supersonic Sky Strike.
Oh, yeah.
Look, if you got it, why not use it?
Of course. You have to use it here. Even if Tapu Lele protects itself from this Supersonic Sky Strike, it's still going to deal a pretty good chunk of chip damage, and then it's going to be in KO range from Earthquake the following turn.
Tapu Lele looking like a delicious berry there as Salamence dives for it, picks up the KO. The Latin American players in the stadium are starting to go a little bit crazy here as the high horsepower connects with Arcanine. Paul Ruiz forcing a game three here for the right to battle in the finals.
Oh, this is so hype. Game three between these two regions who have never made it to the finals of the World Championship in the Masters Division before. One of these countries is going to be represented. One more game. Can't wait to see who it's going to be.
Paul Ruiz has to be feeling himself after that game. After Sam was in complete control game one, Paul coming back and controlling the game two, making those adjustments on turn zero, the lead matchup, making sure that Ninetales couldn't just get a free Aurora Veil out and then just sort of stall out the game, really changing it, protecting that Alolan Marowak. Really smart adjustments from Paul.
Yeah, love those adjustments. But if I'm Sam, I'm looking back to kind of one of the safer lead options that I was looking at before this match even started. I think the combination of Mandibuzz and Tapu Lele do very well as a lead with something like Arcanine and Zerkatry in the back for later in the match. We saw how useful Aurora Veil was, but losing Ninetales so freely, I just don't know if the Aurora Veil was worth it. Meanwhile, this Mandibuzz can really threaten the Marowak. And we've seen on Paul's side, he doesn't have very good options on dealing with this Mandibuzz. So if I'm Sam, looking to game three, the adjustment I'm making, I'm going with Tapu Lele Mandibuzz lead and either Arcanine and Zerkatry in the back, or at least one of them. I'd probably go with both, but that's the adjustment I would make if I'm Sam.
Yeah, and I do think that That's a really interesting adjustment to make because it really changes how this team plays. With the Ninetales setting up the Aurora Veil, you're kind of just sort of slugging it out there with the getting up your boost on Tail Glow and just trying to survive a few attacks. With the Tailwind, you now basically completely eliminate the threat of that Salamence outspeeding and earthquaking your Pokemon if you can manage your Tailworm, your Tailwind turns properly. Let's go, Paul, is the cry from the crowd.
Yeah,
they are ready.
You need a way to deal with the Marowak better. We saw how crucial it was in the matchup. It combined with Celesteel. It was just too difficult to take out the combination of those two Pokemon with what Sam had to work with. So That's why I would love the adjustment. Mandibuzz, so tough to deal with, but that foul play just would deal so much damage to Marowak. And the speed control doesn't hurt because we saw the end game with Salamence. It's just faster than everything and able to clean up. And Ninetales, you know, the Aurora Veil is a great move and all, but it just went down too easily. I really think that for Sam, that adjustment will pay dividends. But it's also entirely possible for Paul to shake things up here in game three, maybe expecting Sam to no longer lead with that Zerkatree Ninetales because he just hard countered it. The combination of Celesteel and Marowak in game number two, it was just, it put him in such a great, great position starting immediately from turn one.
All right, here we go. Game three, top four, Australia versus Ecuador. Sam Pendelis versus Paul Ruiz. Our crowd is
listen
on its
to that crowd.
Oh, holy moly. You would not believe that it is 10:30 here in Anaheim. All of our players are on their feet ready for this game, and it is going to be a switch up from these players. Sam going with the Ninetales again, but bringing the Garchomp along this time up against that Celesteela and Marowak for Paul. So a slight adjustment here on Sam's side, getting a lot more offensive pressure on that Marowak down immediately.
Yeah, I like this adjustment by Sam because he really did need to do something to deal with the Marowak. I was suggesting the Mandibuzz, but Garchomp does the job as well thanks to its potential Tectonic Rage, and it can even set up with Sword Stance if you're predicting this kind of switch.
Yeah, really quick moves coming out here. Both players know what they're trying to do here. Marowak switches out for Snorlax. Ninetales gets its Aurora Veil up again, and Garchomp does go for the Swords Dance. That is a really scary Land Shark right about now. Celesteela will be able to pick up the KO on this Ninetales again with the Heavy Slam, but now it's the Garchomp boosting alongside the Ninetales, not the Zerkatree, and that is a much better matchup against that Marowak.
Yeah, this is big. Even though Celesteela is getting the defense boost here, if Sam has something to deal with Celesteela in the back, whether it be Zerkatree, whether it be Arcanine, you know, Marowak coming in here is now no longer an option because this Garchomp is just too threatening.
Completely covered.
Exactly, and Celesteela, not a Pokemon known for being able to deal a whole lot of damage. Snorlax as well needs to get set up to be able to deal a lot of damage. So Garchomp, full HP, has the Aurora Veil up, has the Sword Stance boost, is in a great position here to clean up game number three, especially alongside the Zerkatree.
All right, Zerkatree out on the field for Sam. Two huge offensive threats on Sam's side, staring down two huge defensive threats, the Celesteela and the Snorlax. But that Garchomp getting that crucial Sword Stance, exerting so much pressure against Paul's side.
Yeah, and I don't even know if you can switch at this point. You might have to try, but it's going to be so difficult. But here, Rock Slide coming out.
Garchomp just going for a Rock Slide. No switches coming out from Paul's side. Zerkatree does get a Thunderbolt off, this time onto Celesteela. No Tail Glow.
Oh.
No Electric Terrain. Celesteela still survives, but Zerkatree avoids the Leech Seed. Not going to take any of that damage, not going to be healing back up that Celesteela. Snorlax's Facade into Garchomp does negligible damage, just about as much as the Rough Skin dealt back.
Yeah, that was a very low amount of damage to a Pokemon as bulky as Garchomp, especially with Aurora Veil up. And even Leech Seed, I don't know if connecting with that would have ended up mattering because, you know, the Celesteela just lost way too much of its HP. Snorlax as well is in such a low range, and it's not threatening damage here. The combination of these two Pokemon are just, they're putting out way too much pressure for Paul to deal with here at this point. It's going to be really tough to come back from this.
And there is still an Aurora Veil up.
Yeah, that's so hard to try and break through because these two Pokemon do become quite bulky, especially we saw Zerkatree does have the berry. Should it even get low enough? Right now, it's not even close to getting low enough for the berry, but if it does get to that point, it's just going to heal all the way back up.
Absolutely. Paul Ruiz needs a break here, needs something if he is going to keep his tournament alive. Sam Pendelis has to be seeing victory in his sights. Still early, but having both the Zerkatree and the Garchomp out relatively safely is a huge moment for this team. Rock Slide into the Protect, Celesteela not taking damage, but Snorlax will. Going to take a lot of damage from that boosted Rock Slide. Does put Snorlax into the berry percentage though, so we'll be able to recover all of that health right back and survive a potential Thunderbolt.
Oh,
Zerkatree's just going for Tail Glows, and now both Zerkatree and Garchomp have boosted their attack. High horsepower is decent damage, but under that Aurora Veil with no critical hit, heard some of the players out there hoping for it,
yeah,
but not getting it. Zerkatree in a strong position here.
Yeah, now both of these Pokemon have boosted stats, ready to take out some KOs. Garchomp is incredibly fast as well. It is naturally faster than Salamence, so even if something like Salamence is in the back, it's going to be really tough to deal with Garchomp, especially through the Aurora Veil, and you've got Zerkatree left. Marowak doesn't want to face down the Garchomp. While it is strong against Zerkatree, just not a good position right here for Paul. Sam has played this early game fantastic. He's got his key sweepers set up. If Paul can somehow hang on and get these Pokemon low enough, then maybe in the end game he can somehow pull through again like he did in game two, but it's just going to be so difficult at this point. He's already got Celesteela low, Snorlax. It's taking way too much damage from these boosted
Looks
Pokemon.
Like Paul's taking a risk here. Switches out Celesteela for the Marowak. Has the fingers crossed. Snorlax also switching out for Salamence. Getting that Intimidate off onto Garchomp. But that Zerkatree does have the option of a tail of the Dazzling Gleam, rather, which would pick up the KO onto this Salamence. Actually going to be the Tectonic Rage coming out from the Garchomp. Did it catch the Marowak on the switch-in?
You have to imagine it's towards that Salamence slot, which it is. If this is a Thunderbolt,
it's a Dazzling Gleam.
Smart play there by Sam.
Covers both options
it
there.
It absolutely does. So fantastic play there by Sam. And now the main sweeping option for Paul in the late game goes down. That was his one chance there to try and get Salamence in and able to pick up knockouts, hoping that it would be faster than the Garchomp and getting a supersonic Sky Strike off onto it before it can attack. That was his one chance. So close. He needed Sam to make a mistake and go for the Thunderbolt, but Dazzling Gleam was enough to knock out the Celesteela, and it covers the Salamence switch-in, so very, very safe and standard play by Sam there, but we see the kind of dividends that those types of plays pay off, because this is such a pressure-filled situation. It's easy to just go for the Thunderbolt without thinking, you know, at 100% clarity, but Sam did stay cool, calm, went for the Dazzling Gleam, great play, and he's in prime position to take this game 3 and advance to the finals.
Paul Ruiz only has Marowak, Celesteela, and Snorlax left. Sam took that early Pokemon deficit when Ninetales went down, but instead of like in game 2 when he was only relying on Zerkatree and having supportive Pokemon alongside the Zerkatree, the Ninetales actually let a free switch in for another offensive threat here. Being able to do the double threat of Garchomp and Zerkatree really changed the flow of this game as Sam switches out his Garchomp for the Arcanine just to get off a little bit of Intimidate onto the Marowak to make sure that it's not going to be dealing that much damage if it starts getting attacks off.
Yeah.
Celesteela does show the Wide Guard to protect Paul's Marowak. Nothing Zerkatree can do this turn as far as offense goes. So no damage there. Marowak does get a Flare Blitz off. Will be connecting with Sam's Zerkatree there. Deals a good amount of damage. Not enough to get the KO, but does get enough to activate the berry.
Yep, and now Zerkatree heals all the way back up. So Ninetales, Aurora Veil, maybe, you know, it might have helped in that one situation there where it lived with just a little bit of HP remaining. But Aurora Veil really wasn't even needed. We saw how little damage both the Garchomp and the Zerkatree were taking And at this point, you know, Ninetales just did its job. It went down. It was able to get Garchomp a free switch, and just fainting was enough for Ninetales. Just getting Zerkatry and Garchomp in at the same time was all that was needed, because these two Pokemon just provide way too much of a threat together. It's very, very tough to deal with them.
Yeah, such a well-played turn one there from Sam, recognizing that he did not need to protect the Ninetales at all, just needed to use the momentum that a knockout would give him for those free switch-ins. Now, Paul still has the Marowak, but we are looking much more like game one, where that Arcanine is threatening the Celesteela, so nothing really gets done here. Snorlax will switch in, though, while Zerkatry fires off another Dazzling Gleam, but that is a much more boosted Dazzling Gleam than before, and it deals so much damage to both of these Pokemon, as Arcanine's Flare Blitz onto that Snorlax will be able to pick up that KO as well. Sam Pendelis, looks like we're about to have our first finalist.
Yep, looks like Australia is going to be advancing into the finals.
Uh-oh. You hear that?
I hear it. Reminiscent of U.S. internationals.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we talked a lot about don't sleep on Latin America, but don't sleep on Australia, one of the only regions to get two international championships, the only region to win two international championships, of course. Zoe won the home court advantage of the Australian International Championships. Christopher Kahn won the North American International Championships. And now, for the first time in VGC Masters history, Australia will be sending a representative to the finals of the World Championships.
Yeah, this is huge for Australia, because they had such an incredible season leading up to this, and now it's culminating at the World Championship. They are sending one of their top players into the finals to compete against whichever Japanese player is winning
there
on the other stream. Look at that emotion.
Australia has made it.
Man, look how excited Sam is. He can't even believe it.
Australia is sending their first representative to the World Championship finals. This time tomorrow, well, actually, I guess much earlier tomorrow, we may have our first Australian world champion in Sam Pendelis. Great tournament so far from him. I'm so excited to see how he continues this momentum tomorrow. But before we get to that, Paul Ruiz, representing Ecuador, had some amazing plays in that top eight match against Adorian, and in that game two of this top four set, showing that he is a player who knows how to adapt.